Cannabis. It's a dance for something like public intoxication. Most of you have done this. Things like disorderly conduct, reckless driving, the fine is similar to a speeding ticket, perhaps a few months of jail time in egregious situations. But this misdemeanor is very difficult to prove. You have to catch somebody in the actual act of crossing the border. So most undocumented immigrants are charged with a violation of the U.S. Civil Code called unauthorized presence. Unauthorized presence is not a violation of the U.S. Criminal Code. It is not a criminal act. In fact, this is what Melania Trump was guilty of. She was working in the United States without a visa. She Certainly, some unauthorized immigrants have committed criminal behaviors, but this is exceedingly unusual. Immigrants rarely commit criminal acts of any sort. Immigrants in general commit fewer crimes than the native-born. Incarceration rates among young men are lowest for immigrants, even among the undocumented population. Moreover, higher rates of immigration, whether authorized or not, are associated with lower rates of both property and violent crime. On top of this, in communities where police have engaged in immigration enforcement activities, cooperation with community members with the police dries up, thereby heightening the potential for crime. The resolution before us is hardly an invitation to unauthorized immigrants to come to Kingston to break our laws and take advantage of our goodwill. Of the 11 million undocumented immigrants in the U.S., virtually none of them are here in Ulster County. Most of the undocumented workers in Ulster County are migrants passing through with the harvest out in the rural areas west of Kingston. The 2010 estimate figured that of the roughly 2,000 farm workers who pass through the county, about 75% are undocumented. But these numbers hardly matter. These immigrants pass through the county and do not set down roots here, certainly not in Kingston City. The real point of the resolution is to assure all those who immigrate to Kingston that they will be free to establish their businesses, to work side by side with us, to send their children to school without fearing for their safety, to share the benefits they help produce. Immigrants are vital partners in the development of peaceful streets. I cannot for the life of me understand why those against this resolution would not want to support the improvement of law and order. Those of you who are concerned the resolution will lead to a diminished local economy and a higher crime level, I ask you, what possible motivation would Mayor Noble, Police Chief Tenty, and the many neighbors who have urged passage of this resolution, what possible motive would they have to wreck the economy and increase crime? Why in the world would any responsible public official or local citizen want to decrease our quality of life? We have listened to those of you who have spoken out against the resolution. We ask you to listen to the evidence to realize that the aim of the resolution is to better our community, to enliven the economy, to protect our citizens to the fullest extent possible. Some of you have asked, if this resolution is merely symbolic, why bother passing? It was a symbolic act when, in a moment of immigration crisis, we erected the Statue of Liberty with its inviting slogan, which has been mentioned before, give us your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free. It was a symbolic act when, during a moment of economic crisis, Franklin Roosevelt said, all we have to fear is fear itself. It was a symbolic act when, during a moment of racial crisis, Martin Luther King stood at the Lincoln Memorial and dreamed of a day when we would all be judged solely by the content of our character. Symbolic acts articulate our most deeply held values. At a moment like this, we must choose a side. Which side are we on? The tyranny of the federal government or the freedom of the individual? Which side are we on? The selfish cynicism of insularity or the warm welcome of community? Which side are we on? The petty vindictiveness of the few or economic opportunity for all? I side with the freedom of a welcome and inclusive community where we foster economic opportunity for every one of us. For this reason, I will vote in favor of the resolution.
That's old councilman in the back. That was amazing. He said enough for everybody. And it was very, very fair. It was very, very inclusive. I just want to also commend the other council members. I believe in my heart that it's okay for us to disagree. We have to accept that this stuff happened. It's okay. But I have to also commend some of the council members last night that were standing up saying, they were white people that were saying, I believe and I understand it, that it's different for me. That I don't have to deal with some of the inconsistencies that other people of color have to deal with. I commend people for doing that, because if you're all right, you could just be all right and not worry about me or anybody else of color. But to speak out like that shows so much character. It's amazing. And I think that's what the mayor is doing here by making this statement and in the assembly of the Statue of Liberty. That was fabulous. Because there's so much meaning in it. It might not change a law, but there's a lot of meaning in it. And just thank you all for being patient tonight. And hopefully we're going to do the right thing for you today.
Thank you, sir. This has certainly generated a lot. We've been listening to very passionate opinions for the last couple of weeks or month or even longer. We've all been getting phone calls. We've discussed this quite a bit. We have heard a lot more opinions tonight on the subject. And at the end of the day, most of them were opinions. There were very few facts here tonight. You know, most everybody spoke from their heart, which I think is the best thing we can have. You know, we heard from both sides, and I respect the opinions on both sides. I'm going to tell you why I am going to support this. I have heard this. Well, you guys are easy to get applause from. Anyway, as we listen, one of the things I've heard, there is a lot of concern, shall we say, out and out fear of what may happen, not fear of our police department. I have not heard one comment that anyone has been treated unfairly by our police. I expect that to continue. Could things change? Absolutely. And that's one of the things we've heard on the schedule. There's a lot of maybe not things about, you know, an influx of people to the area, maybe not. Cost, maybe not. A lot of things, but I come back to the fear. And this is probably the only fact I'm going to say tonight. College was a hazy experience, but I do remember one thing. And I've heard this said, that some of the fears are irrational. Now, I do remember this. I was a psychology major, so I must know what I'm talking about, right? I don't believe there's any such thing as an irrational fear. Fear is fear. And I really can't imagine anything worse in life than living in fear of something. And yeah, it may be irrational. I can't tell my grandkids that the dark upstairs is an irrational fear. They're scared to death to go up in the dark. It's fear. You can see the fear on them. You can hear the fear in voices here. And if passing this resolution tonight alleviates even one person's fear, I think we have served the community well.
Both sides of this issue. It's very, you know, very controversial topic. And as I stated last night, sometimes, you know, we're going to agree to disagree. But after the December 20th Laws and Rules meeting, I was asked if I was a yes or no for this resolution. I replied at that time, I was in favor of a resolution. However, I wanted to do more research on the issue. Yes, Rennie, I did my research as well. After reading the proposed resolution, doing more research and speaking and listening to people on both sides of this issue. Sometimes it was good conversations. Sometimes people are just screaming and yelling at me on both sides, and I just sat there and listened. I asked myself this question, is a resolution needed now? My response to this question is this. Prior history has shown that there have been other issues of safety and security concerns that many residents of this community had faced. The concerns in the early 1900s was anti-immigration. In the 1940s, 60s, it was segregation. In the 1990s, the concern was homosexuality. And then the concern of the post 9/11 was religious hysteria. During these times, Kingston continued to be a welcoming and inclusive city. And there was no resolution needed to prove that. Now, it's 2017, and the label of sanctuary city is the issue of concern. Again, the question is a resolution needed now? As both the Kingston Police Chief and Ulster County Sheriff have stated, this resolution will not change how we do business in the community. That is, it does not inquire into, that is, they will not inquire into a person's immigration status upon initial contact. So my answer to this question is that Kingston has and will always be a welcoming and inclusive city to all. And I believe, just like in the past, no resolution is necessary to prove this. I believe that we, the community, need to continue to celebrate the unity and diversity we have in Kingston. So my vote will be a no on this resolution.
Alderman Acker.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, everyone, for coming out. It's been a very long evening, and I'll try to just highlight a few points that I think deserve highlighting. Many of you have spoken far more eloquently than I can about these issues. I just also want to reiterate, I think it's worthwhile to thank the mayor again, because this took a lot of moral courage. We always see So I just want to highlight a couple of reasons. There are lots of principled reasons to support this resolution. There are lots of pragmatic reasons. I just want to touch upon the pragmatic reasons for a moment. And I think the main reason comes from the chief of police. The chief of police tells us this is what he already does. He's clarifying this position along with the mayor. And it's to help keep our city safe. People aren't going to call in to tell us that crimes have been committed against them or call in with important information that we all need to keep ourselves safe. So to me, this is reaffirming, again, what we're already doing and clarifying in a very important way. The other thing I want to touch upon is something that Alderman Brown raised, and that's the legality of all of this. And what I would say is that the Supreme Court has handed down multiple decisions that protect local government from enforcing federal law. We have a system of federalism in the United States, and the national government can't commandeer the states or localities to do their federal job. Local police officers aren't trained to be immigration agents, and local tax dollars should go towards supporting unfunded federal mandates. Where the federal government or the national government can't commandeer states or localities, they also can't take away federal funding as a punishment. That's the Supreme Court law, and a lot of those decisions have been spearheaded by conservative groups, particularly to conservative groups who went after Obamacare and didn't want to support it. So this is a kind of progressive federalism. It's perfectly within our constitutional rights to do so, and we as a locality take an oath to the United States Constitution, the state constitution, and we have a right to interpret it as well, and that's what we're doing. The other thing that I want to highlight here is this idea that the resolution is meaningless. You would not be here speaking passionately against it if it were not. Have you talked to someone who is the target of a lot of these attacks? And they will tell you it's not meaningless, it's meaningful. I just want to raise a few more points, and I promise I'll end. Again, this is not, we're not declaring Kingston a sanctuary city. We're stopping short of it. We're doing so to avoid the very morass that Alderman Brown is talking about, right? So we are not going to be in the lens and the target of Republican Congress who will come after potentially sanctuary cities. We're not sure about that yet. We'll have to wait and see what happens. The other thing I would say, it's not a zero-sum game, right? We can pass this resolution tonight and write letters to our members of Congress and say, and that is that we need these undocumented immigrants for our economy to function, right? That's the dirty little secret. If you shift from all home tomorrow, your economic status would not be any better. And by some measures, it would actually be worse. So I think a lot of what's going on here is people are experiencing frustration and pain. They're having trouble making ends meet, right? And they feel like, hey, I'm struggling to make ends meet. I'm law-abiding, no one's coming here and helping me out. But these undocumented migrant workers or immigrants are not the source of our pain. And it's a distraction. What we ought to be doing is sticking together and going after the people who have unfairly redistributed wealth from the United States. To the extent that we are out there, I'm very proud of my fellow aldermen here for speaking their mind on both sides of the issue. And this is what democracy is all about. So thank you for coming out tonight.
Yes, thank you, Mr. President. I'm going to address the fluff part of this because everyone else has touched upon the rest. Unlike Alderman Davis, Alderman Scott Childers, I don't know if you have any statistics for this, but this has to be the most intense memorializing resolution in the history of because as a legislative resolution, yes, it is meaningless. The police aren't going to change what they do. They can't. Nothing the federal government can do is going to change. Nothing legally is changing here. And when this first got proposed, I was not in favor because I didn't see why. But here it is, you know, hours and hours and phone calls and conversations later, and tears and stories later, you realize it's not meaningless to the people that are affected. I don't have to worry, looking like I'm going to have to worry about it. I'll close on this, we've been here a while. Is it meaningless? If you tell a loved one or a family member that you love them, that's not going to put money in their pocket, that's not going to put a car in their driveway, that's not going to better their economic standing. But is that really meaningless? That's a rhetorical question.
Is there anyone else on the question before I call for the vote?
I just want to make
a
response to Alderman Ecker. I'm just reading under the Articles of the Confederation under Article 6 of the United States Constitution. It's just a very small paragraph. Clause 2 provides that the Constitution, federal laws made pursuant to, and treaties made under its authority, constitute the supreme law of the land. It provides that state courts are bound by the supreme law. In case of conflict between federal and state law, the federal law must be applied. Even state constitutions are subordinate to federal law. Thank you. And like I said, as I mentioned before, Lynn, everybody's talking about the new administration. Yes, things are going to change, okay? But I think some of us are almost having knee-jerk reactions at certain points. Don't forget there's Democrats on the council, on in the Senate, and the government. But my biggest concern is for the financial aspect that's my biggest concern, because whatever we don't get from grants, we have to tax the taxpayers, and we have to make do for that. We have to pass it on to somebody. So mine was more financial, but I also wanted to remind you about the supremacy law.
Thank you.
Alderman Anderson.
Yeah, there are different definitions of federalism that have been in operation throughout American history. That's a broad general concept, but we argue about a particular theory of federalism you apply. So the theory that's been in operation under the past couple of cases that I cited has been that of dual federalism, where the state government operates in a realm where it is given power and it is given responsibilities and obligations. Federal government may not transgress, and in the federal government, national government, has obligations and responsibilities. We're not in any way violating them. We are simply saying to the national government, if this is your law, enforce it. That's all we're doing.
Okay, hearing no other discussion, I'm going to call for the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The resolution is adopted. I'll give you a couple of minutes.